Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our last event for April, being it's like an event being hosted by the Eastern Cape region. And hosting you today is my co-host, Robin Williams, and myself, Lucy Chizunza. Earlier last week on the 23rd, that's right, Isaka sent us a message declaring the week for celebrating all our members and delegates and even the speakers that come on board for Happy Freedom Day. And before we get started, I'd like us to share a couple of housekeeping items. Firstly, can we all please ensure that our mics are on mute and cameras off to eliminate any background noise during the webinar and presentations? This event is being recorded and will be made available on our YouTube channel. The channel name is Isaka South Africa, if you would like to watch this webinar again or watch any of the previous webinars done by our chapter. If you have any questions, you can submit your questions at any time during the webinar by simply using our chat panel and at the bottom of the screen, and we have dedicated question and answer slot at the end of each speaker's session. So after the first speaker, we'll take questions, and after the second panel, we'll also take questions and have your questions answered. We are hosting a two-day online conference on the 7th of June, yay! On the 7th and 8th this year, themed Adapting in Changing Times. Registration is still open and tickets cost 2,000 for members and 2.5 for non-members. Another positive for being a member, right? So you get to save. Group discounts are available. To benefit the discount, you can contact our Isaka office via email or by calling the number on the screen. And we're also having another event on the 4th of June, the annual virtual conference, and our host is Shane. On the 9th and 10th of June, we have a virtual conference for 2021 being hosted by Tichao Nezororo, and members 2.2, non-members 2.5, and registrations are open. So on this conference, we are looking for organizations or individuals to sponsor our event. Sponsorship packages range from 4,000 to 21,000. So you can, you know, there's a lot of slots you can choose there. You can refer to our Isaka Engage site for information regarding the various sponsorship packages offered and the benefits of each package that you would have chosen or that you would be contemplating on choosing. And in other news, I can apply for a provisional designation today in information systems audit profession or information security management professional. You can kindly submit your completed application form with supporting documentation to saqa@isaka.org.za. We encourage you to continue to apply for these professional designations at no cost. The cybersecurity fundamentals exam is being updated and will become one of the five stickable certificates forming part of the information technologies certified associate, also the ITCA certification. The new cybersecurity fundamentals exam will be available from the 1st of June 2021. In the meantime, candidates may register for and take the current old version of the exam until the 30th of May by registering to the link that is on the international website. For those who need training, we also covered. For the CISM exam workshops, we have some lined up in July on all Saturdays. So that's on the 3rd, the 10th, the 17th and 24th of July. The same goes for CISA, but that's in August now. So that's the 7th, 14th, 21 and 28th. And those are shorter classes from 9 a.m. to 1, around about lunchtime. Now that we have all that out of the way now, the reason that we are all here today why we're excited to be here this afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, for this online forum, we have a first speaker and a panel coming in the second segment. So I hope you are excited as I am. Our first speaker, ladies and gentlemen, has spent not months, not years, but decades selling, building, supporting computer systems. And then for the past 6 years, he has focused almost exclusively on making them more secure. His most recent work has been centered around helping clients prepare to respond to cyber attacks and to respond to them with particular focus on learning, practicing, and refining the aspects of people, processes, and technology through crisis management. Today, you'll be speaking on practical steps to prioritize third-party risks against the threat actor pyramid. I don't know if it's just me who comes across certain people or individuals in society. You know, when you see someone who is married with a qualification that you endeavor to do, and you ask them for guidance. So how did you get your CISA? Lucy, how did you get your CISA? Then I give them a response like, oh, just plan well. If you want to, go for it. It leaves the other person, well, in a worse position than they started. But I'm glad today our speaker is giving us practical steps to prioritize third-party risk against the threat actor pyramid. What is the threat actor pyramid? Oh, well, me and you both are going to wait and hear from Trifon Katakuzinos. Ladies and gentlemen, help me make welcome to our speaker for the day. Trifon, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was such a good introduction. I was looking forward to seeing who it was going to be. So I hope I don't disappoint. Let me sort out the sharing here. So I'm hoping I've got a screen sharing. That up. Sorry, Lucy, is my screen coming through? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you. Yeah, so my original talk title was that rather wordy practical steps to prioritize third-party risk. But while I was working on the talk, I realized that it's probably more accurate to talk about resilience, because that's what I'm hoping to contribute to. I also realized after I submitted my profile picture that it was a bit old and it had a beard that I shaved off about a year and a half ago. So I had to do my best to grow back a bit of a beard so that I didn't look too much too different from what was originally shared. You might have guessed from my surname that my ancestors did spend some significant time in what we now call Greece. My Twitter bio is dad jokes, puns, growing food, cyber, occasional philosophy. You're welcome to follow me if any of those things sound of interest to you. Otherwise, you're more than welcome to reach out to me on LinkedIn if you'd like to connect. I've been with F-Secure since 2015, having come from a technical IT background. And yes, I've taken a fairly windy route along the way. But yes, firmly entrenched at F-Secure. And in the time that I've been there, I've been exposed to a bunch of cyber attacks up close. And some of those have been performed by our red teams in targeted attack simulations. Some of those have been real attacks that our incident response team has been responding to. And some of those have been attacks that we've hypothesized as part of crisis management exercises that we run with clients. I've seen some aspects of supply chain in all of those instances. They're popping up a lot more as we go. And definitely anticipate that we are going to see more of this as more and more business processes get digitized and spread across multiple organizations. Much of what I'm going to talk about today is pretty familiar to everybody. you know, I'm not going to be reinventing the wheel. If you're familiar with security, the third party aspects are really just an offshoot of that traditional defending. So just give some extra thoughts to what you're already doing. So in light of the familiar things, this is, you know, this is the typical attacker kill chain that we've talked about for years. And it's just a way of demonstrating in a simplified way how attackers do attack. They don't just arrive at on your Swift infrastructure. They have to make their way there. You know, over the years, we've gotten a lot better at defending. It's the reality, you know, particularly financial services, insurance, the telcos. You know, these have been targets for a very long time, and we've done a lot to improve security and make it a lot harder for the attackers. So one of the offshoots of that is that they're going to look for easier ways. So if they can bypass you and find an easier way by doing that on somebody else's network, then they're certainly going to give it a try, particularly if that drops them very close to their objectives. But they're going to take anything that gets them closer. You know, the further along this chain that a third party can take them, the less they have to deal with your preventative, detective, and response controls. So they're definitely going to look to bypass those. I'm sure you've all heard the story of my distant ancestors and you know, how they ended a 10-year siege and avoided a very costly battle by engineering their way past the walls and gates of the city of Troy by hiding in a giant wooden horse. Now, I'm sure many of you have, you probably own these TSA approved locks that you put on your luggage, and they allow TSA agents to open up the lock if they suspect there's something inside without just getting a bolt cutter and cutting it off. But, you know, I wonder how many of you remember the time that the TSA published a photograph of their master keys, and a hacker, fortunately a researching hacker, managed to figure out a way to 3D print the master keys from the photos. And that basically meant that he could take these 8 keys and open millions of bags and steal whatever he wanted from inside. Now, attackers might target third parties if the supply chain, if they want to amplify their reach and lower the cost of attacking multiple targets by having somebody else do the work of distributing their malware. Breaching networks is expensive and time consuming and often requires a lot of trial and error. So a master key is great. Anything that's going to speed up the process and save a lot of effort. The 2020 SolarWinds attacks, which I'm sure people must be familiar with, they've been all over the news, but they definitely ticked both of these boxes. You know, the attackers obtained footholds on hundreds of extremely well-secured networks with a few lines of code that they injected into the right build server. The time they spent on the initial attack was repaid thousands of times based on the access that they received down the line. And they were able to leverage that initial attack to achieve some pretty astonishing levels of access. Now, not all threats to the supply chain are necessarily malicious, but the impact is no less disruptive. Vulnerabilities in code are a reality of life at this point, as are the all too frequent S3 buckets accidentally exposed to the public. In the latter case, your company could end up in the news because a researcher happens to find your data, and the reputational damage could be significant, not to mention the potential regulatory sanctions and the impact to those whose data is exposed. Now, honestly, I created the slide just because when the Ever Given ran aground, someone tweeted something like, "This picture is going to be in every slide deck this year, and I'm not going to be the guy that stops that from coming true." I guess this could be the alternate slide to demonstrate the same thing. Again, accidents happen and they can be very costly and embarrassing. So we really want to be building resilience in wherever possible. Now, we talk about supply chain, but in reality, most supply chains are this recursive, multi-level agglomeration of diverse organizations that may or may not be aware of each other. You won't need to dig too deep below the surface to realize how complex things become. In preparing for this talk and mulling over some scenarios in my head, I've very often found myself stuck in a loop, a few levels down with no idea where I was or how to get back to the surface. And I was reminded of that warning, when you stare into the abyss stares back. I would suggest, therefore, that you approach this by focusing your efforts on your most direct partners first. Unless, of course, you identify a critical path or a critical system that you want to address immediately end to end. Trying to do this all at once will really leave you tied up in knots. So here is the infamous attacker pyramid. And honestly, it's just a way to visualize that not all attackers are motivated by the same things, nor do they have the same skills or capabilities. And it's really just a shorthand way to refer to different classes of attackers. This is not a real thing. It's really just an abstraction that's useful in conversation. And one of the things that we really need to remember is that the cost of defending goes up dramatically the closer you get to the top of the attack pyramid. It's just the reality. It's much easier to defend against script kiddies, unsophisticated people, but the cost goes up. The other thing to bear in mind is that the types of techniques and tactics that people are towards the top end of the pyramid, such as nation states, stuff that they use today that might be extremely novel and extremely sophisticated, over time, that stuff trickles down and eventually it's available to pretty much everybody. By using this pyramid, you can think about who's likely to be attacking you. And this is going to save you a lot of time down the road, a lot of money, and it's probably going to save your sanity. You probably don't want to prioritize defending against nation states unless you have a really good reason to believe that they're part of your threat model. And you shouldn't feel too bad if you don't believe that you're capable of defending against nation states. Just based on the SolarWinds attack in itself, which was most certainly nation state. And the only reason they really got caught in the end was because they targeted a security company. And one of the mistakes they made down the line got picked up as an anomaly and got investigated by a really good security team. So in things that you can do, this is a thing that's not always obvious to everybody, but what is valuable to your organization? That's going to vary for everybody. And you need to figure out what is it that you most need to protect. People tend to point out the obvious assets like money or intellectual property, but they often fail to consider their key business processes. Many of these processes may play out across multiple organizations and may involve dozens of systems that each play their role. Our red teams often attack these business processes as part of attack simulations. They naturally spend their time doing all of the technical hacking, phishing, looking for exposed services, and positioning themselves on the network. But the rest of the attack is honestly spent finding out information and finding out the easiest way to subvert their business processes that will allow them to execute on the goals without getting caught. Sometimes that's as simple as editing and changing some detail in a CSV file that's sitting on a file share, waiting to get picked up as part of a batch process. This is significantly quicker and a lot easier than looking for and exploiting some obscure vulnerability in a payments application. The process of identifying your crown jewels should help you to earmark some of the third parties most directly related to your most critical assets. I would suggest that it makes sense to prioritize these partners early on. I would further suggest that we should expect a high level of assurance with regard to their security practices. It is worth spending some time understanding their relationship in relation to the critical assets and identify the ways in which their interaction introduces new attack paths. That is, in what ways do they contribute to existing routes or create novel routes which might be leveraged in an attack? Hopefully, much of this work has already been done, and you can just come in and contribute the third-party view. If not, then I'm afraid you do have a fair bit of work ahead of you. I know that a lot of work goes into these when we perform these attack path mapping exercises for clients, but the effort definitely helps down the line, because you should be able to prioritize and minimize the controls by focusing on the intersections of the most numerous attack paths. It's also significantly easier then to evaluate whether controls are effective, because we know exactly what actions they are meant to prevent or detect. By way of example, if you have an outsourced partner in your environment, then you have undoubtedly battled with enabling them to do their work without completely sacrificing your security posture. Many organizations have outsourced partners running the most critical IT functions. They often have domain admin credentials. They often connect to the corporate network with their devices that you don't manage. You have a limited view of their security practices. No idea if they're emailing around your service account passwords to their colleagues who are taking over the next shift. I have seen clients issue these people with their own corporate laptops to at least avoid having foreign devices on their network. Some use NAC and posturing as a way to ensure that the endpoints that are connecting are at least at a minimum level of hygiene and have things like antivirus in place. Some clients force them to connect over a VPN. And I don't know that any of these are perfect technical solutions or that there is a perfect technical solution, but it's definitely worth gauging the effort that you put into solving this problem against the level of privilege that these outsource providers hold. If they manage your AD, then you definitely want to spend time on this and find a way that works. For lesser privileged partners, you probably want to consider some administrative controls to get legal to write in some requirements into the contracts and SLAs. Where it makes sense, be sure to have your right to audit defined upfront, so that you have the possibility to assess their security required. On the subject of legal, we do need to ensure that they're involved in this process. While having a liability clause in a contract might not prevent an attacker, it can certainly improve the chances of a company surviving an attack financially. Having minimum requirements and penalties agreed up front also makes complete sense. Sometimes that threat of a punitive sanction will at least motivate some good behavior and encourage them to meet the SLAs. Just remember that in the event of a major incident, it's going to be your name making the news. You're going to be dealing with the fallout, and potentially no one's going to be talking about the provider who made the mistake in the background. The other thing to consider is incidents. So you want to know what's going to happen in an incident. You want to know the roles and responsibility, who's doing what, who's the incident response provider. You might have a provider on your books and the third party might have a different provider on their books. We've had the situation where we get involved with a third party and we have an NDA with our client, but we don't have an NDA with the third party. And that can really slow down the process if you suddenly have to stop in the middle of incidents and try and get some paperwork sorted out. One of the ways to really speed that up is have an incident response retainer and agree all of this up front. You can do some onboarding. You can do some practice runs. You can update processes. You can update your policies. you know, take care of all of that paperwork before the incident happens, because honestly, it's not something you want to be trying to do while everything's on fire. And you know, we found this very recently with the Exchange vulnerability that was released. It had massive broad impact across the world, and there literally just weren't enough incident responders available. And I think there were a lot of panicked calls that went out looking for support. So definitely you want to make sure that you have these things planned for and that you have them in place up front. Again, planning for the worst, you know, since we're talking about response, this is a personal experience. I've been working on a lot of tabletop simulations, all kinds of exercises with clients, running through different kinds of crises and different scenarios. And it really is a useful exercise to get everyone in a room and consider the things that might happen. You know, we typically take what we consider a pretty challenging scenario. Sometimes they're extremely challenging, and you know, there's no expectation of anyone winning, but you know, it challenges everyone, and it gives you a realistic idea of what happens in an incident. You know, we run these at various levels. We run them with the technical teams, with the C-certs. We've run them with dev teams, and across business and up to the executive. You know, it gives everybody a view of what could happen. And if you incorporate the aspects of third party, and particularly if you can include your third parties in the process, you get a much better result. And everyone gets to understand just how bad things can get and can understand why you're asking for the things that you're asking for. You know, we typically get a lot of debate and a lot of collaboration that wouldn't otherwise happen, because suddenly you have a bunch of diverse people in a room that might not necessarily get together normally, but, you know, you light a bit of a fire and, you know, everyone cuddles around and has a good conversation. So I definitely encourage you to face your fears and play out some of the scenarios that you're concerned about, particularly in your critical environments. Or even, you know, across the entire organization. You know, as I mentioned at the start of the talk, I really am interested in resilience. And so it's really important to plan for the worst case scenario. Obviously, hope it doesn't happen, but it makes sure that you can respond quickly and effectively, because delays in response can be catastrophic. So you really want to get ahead of this, be proactive, and make sure that in the event of a real incident, you're ready for action, you're ready to hit the ground, your partners are ready to hit the ground, your response partners are ready to hit the ground, and you can really clean things up quickly. You can also take the learnings from incidents that you do experience. I mean, most large organizations have, you know, smaller incidents that do crop up. You know, you can take the stuff that you hear about in the news, and kind of feed that back into the organization. You know, take the learnings from those and feed them back in across the board. You know, feed them in across prevent, detect, respond, people, process, technology, and again, incorporate your third parties. You know, if you see something in the news, pick up the phone. If you've got a good relationship with those third parties, ask them if you're at risk, ask them if they have specific protections in place, and, you know, hopefully that can also give you a little bit of peace of mind. You want to really be worrying about the things that you should be worrying about and be able to tick off the rest and carry on with your life. So I mentioned privilege quite a few times because it is important, and one of the most effective ways to reduce the likelihood or the impact of an attack is really to practice least privilege. You know, apply it as much as possible everywhere. Avoid giving people or computers more privilege than they need to perform their function without too much hindrance. you know, too often we see overly permissive permissions during incident investigations. And at that point, it's normally too late, and it normally really hampers the recovery operations if you have attackers that have gotten hold of accounts that give them significant privilege in your environment or in a third party's environment. In the same way, you want to avoid exposing sensitive data by not sharing it unnecessarily. If you're integrating with an external system, process, or company, do your best to limit what you share and only share what's absolutely required. You know, you sometimes need to push back on business to make sure that, you know, you're not just doing something because it's easy, but rather put in the work up front and make sure you're only exposing what you need to. You know, where possible, anonymize the data. Don't share your client's ID number with your marketing company when all they need is an email address. And if you do share sensitive information externally, do what you can to secure it in transit and have agreements in place on how it will be stored and used by the third party. And equally important, for how long. This stuff really should be shared on a need-to-know basis and should be destroyed as soon as the need no longer exists. This again speaks to dialogue. You know, you need to be having these conversations across your business and across your partner space. You know, we've always said security isn't solved by the security team. It's an organizational-wide challenge. So there are some situations where privilege is hard to ascertain and even harder to police. Anytime you have a third-party mechanism that could be used to escalate privilege, you need to be concerned and pay special attention. By way of example, if you could consider the average development pipeline and the high levels of trust required when third-party libraries are included. While it may be technically possible to audit every code change, the effort and cost required would be significant and probably entirely unsustainable for organizations using hundreds of third-party tools and plugins. You absolutely need to work with your dev teams and make sure that they understand their role in security. Education and awareness are critical. Everyday behavior may need to be modified. You know, we've seen this regularly where we engage with dev teams. They generally want to do whatever they can to be more secure. They don't necessarily know what they need to do, or they don't necessarily consider the unintended consequences of how they are operating, or they may not know what their options are to be more secure. And again, this applies equally to your dev teams and to third-party dev teams. So, you know, as I mentioned earlier, there's that abstraction layer. You know, you might be doing the dev in-house yourself and have your own pipeline with third-party tools in it, but your third parties typically have their own dev pipelines with their third-party tools. So again, it's just going to go back into to infinity if you don't nip it at some point. So one of the things that you might find useful is some sort of software composition analysis tool, something that's able to catalog all of the third-party software dependencies in your pipeline. And, you know, aside from helping you to ensure that you're licensed, okay, it'll also let you know, monitor for known problems like updated libraries or known bad versions. This will definitely help you in response and recovery in the event of an incident. Again, this is one of those places where when something does make the news that, you know, XYZ tool has been found to have a backdoor, that's not the time when you want to be trying to figure out, do we have this in our environment? You know, is this in some software pipeline somewhere? It's really hard to try to track these down in an incident, but if you have a way that you can easily query this and figure out what versions you have in your environment, it's going to make your life a lot easier dealing with an incident. And again, this is, you know, this is advice that you want to be passing down the chain to your third parties if they're doing dev. So if you're running one or more dev pipelines, as I said earlier, you really want to consider running some sort of tabletop scenario that involves this attack path, whether you do it purely with the dev team or whether you run this with business and you bring in this aspect of what would happen if this pipeline were to get compromised. What would that mean for you? What would that mean for your clients? How would you know if somebody had infiltrated your pipeline? So as challenging as defending is, it's certainly no easier to assess or report on how well you're defending. You know, this is something that many of our clients battle with. How do you know how you're doing? What metrics can you use? How do you report this to EXCO? You know, very often we see organizations that focus on these concrete metrics that are easy to gather, such as, you know, how many malicious emails did you block? Or you track maturity against some industry framework. Now, these all have value, and I'm not saying you shouldn't use them, but it's worth understanding that they have a limited ability to tell you what's going to happen if a sufficiently skilled attacker attacks your organization. And that's one of the reasons that we use those targeted attack simulations and that they are found so valuable, because they do give you that real world view of the organization's resilience. You know, unfortunately, they take significant effort and they aren't practical for day-to-day use. But again, it's going to be about finding that balance between the real world technical exercises and the paper-based exercises. So your standards and frameworks are undoubtedly valuable because they do bring structure and some objective measurement across a broad range of domains. So for example, companies holding ISO 27001, we know that they've at least maintained some minimum level of information security management, and they have the evidence to support it. Does it tell us whether or not they're impervious to an attack? No, but it does indicate that certain minimums are in place, and it gives us a jumping point to continue the conversation. So with an understanding of the challenges inherent in assessing resilience, and you know, there's always going to be this give and take between cost and practicality, we're faced to wonder how to assess the security of third parties, which just complicates matters even more. You know, there are a number of vendors that provide a service that they claim can help you benchmark organizations by analyzing their online presence, and you know, they use their own proprietary criteria to give them a way to score diverse organizations and be able to compare one to another. Some of them augment these sort of open source intelligence gathering processes with more detailed information. You know, some of that's gathered via questionnaires, and you know, some do some pretty detailed assessments that will mark you against a compliance standard. These are certainly valuable, but they do again share the limitation of other industry standards in that they very often rely on information that can't easily be verified technically. When it comes to vendor management, a lot of large organizations have some sort of questionnaire that they use as part of their vendor management process, where they directly ask their supply chain to self-report their security, maturity, and posture. I've seen some detailed spreadsheets that read like a mini ISO audit in themselves. And you know, I've also consulted some companies that are on the receiving end of these questionnaires, and very often they're pretty overwhelmed trying to fill them in your average startup or non-financial services, a smaller company, they often lack those security and risk management functions that we tend to take for granted. And the person filling in this form is often, they often have very limited exposure to stuff that they're being asked about. They might also lack a lot of the legacy structure that we might expect. Many smaller startups are cloud native, and they score pretty poorly on some of these controls assessments because they simply don't have those they don't have those controls in their environment. If you do make up these questionnaires, please be sure to engage with the people and don't just email out the spreadsheet and blindly accept the score. I've certainly seen some companies where people filling in these forms have really scored themselves poorly. They've been very conservative. They haven't understood the question properly and they've done their best to answer it. But, all they need is a little bit of guidance and, a little bit of an understanding of the context of their organization and what they have in the world. Ultimately we want them to be more secure. So it's important to help them to build a roadmap towards compliance, but that also prioritizes security initiatives that are going to positively impact their security posture in the short term. So this isn't meant to be ominous. I'm just letting you know that the talk is nearly over. As with all things cybersecurity, there are few silver bullets, but it's not all doom and gloom. And, you shouldn't throw your hands up in the air and say, this is impossible. When you see some crazy hack in the news, give it some thought, but also consider the likely attacker's skill and motivation and figure out if they're even in your threat model, before you start tearing your hair out. I've had a lot of clients where we see these things in the news and you do get a lot of this kind of hand-wringing and, well, it's pointless. We're never going to be able to protect against these guys. So, maybe we just have to accept that that we can't. And that's not particularly helpful. So, I do suggest that you take a targeted approach to your third parties and understand that you're going to require different levels of assurance based on their criticality to your business and your ability to influence their security posture. Trying to find a one-size-fits-all approach is doomed to fail until we find a better way of working together. So, as an example, we're all using some level of cloud. It's a lot harder to influence the likes of an AWS or Azure. Sometimes you're just going to have to take what they give you and make the best of it. But if you do have partners that you can engage with, you're definitely going to get more bang for your buck. It's going to take some honest human interaction and a shared vision of what we're trying to achieve and building a partnership around security. The us versus them mindset has never been particularly effective. And I'd encourage people to do their best to break down barriers and have those conversations with your partners. I'd venture to guess that half the people listening today are part of my personal supply chain, and vice versa. We're all interconnected and, we all do have a shared responsibility to do what we can to raise the bar because there really is no escape. We can all do what we want personally and secure ourselves as best as possible. But ultimately, again, those connections do make it very hard. We should expect that our information is going to be shared with people. We've all read our terms and conditions, and we know that our information may be shared with third parties and marketing providers, but you know, as organizations, we do have a responsibility to the people that entrust us with our data. And, you know, I'm going to stop talking now and I'll get ready for some questions or comments or suggestions. You know, if you're uncomfortable asking the question now, please feel free to reach out to me offline. I'm certainly keen to hear what people are doing and, you know, what is working and things I might have overlooked. This is it's a broad subject. And as I said, trying to prevent myself from going nuts, I did have to put in some barriers that made sense. So anything else, please let me know.
Thank you so much, Trifon. Thank you so much for such an insightful presentation. I don't know if people can hear me clearly now. I need indication from someone, please.
I hear you.
You can hear me. Oh, thank you. Looks like my face and voice are not on speaking terms today, so I will keep the camera off so that everyone can hear clearly. On that note, I would like to apologize to all our members and attendees today. We apologize for the slight glitch we had at the beginning, but we'll try and make sure that it does not happen again. However, the announcements have been reposted on the chat box, and the presentation will also be available on our YouTube channel after this presentation. Okay, Trifon, we have a couple of questions. Thank you, everyone, for your questions. I see there was a question from Spesile, and Michelle addressed that. Thank you. Then the second one was from Nicole. Do you have any recent practical examples of an attack path mapping exercise you've done for a client, particularly one that deals with third parties? And how such an exercise has been able to benefit them in improving their approach to securing their most critical assets?
So in terms of attack path mapping, there's always a third party involved. I'm trying to think of something concrete. I mean, we have done the dev example that I gave. So, you know, looking at what sort of libraries are in the environment and what sort of tooling is being used, and considering developers. So the environment we looked at had a lot of third-party developers who weren't employees, and there were quite a lot of challenges with the endpoints, because developers are often quite reluctant to install security controls on their machines, because Macs are impervious apparently. So there's not a lot of, it's a tough one to get through. But what it really does is it helps the client to understand the data flows and to understand where those boundaries are. And you know, those help you with prioritizing preventative controls. So figuring out what you can do, you know, what your options are to prevent the bad things happening. You know, once you've done that sort of threat modeling and you get an idea of what can happen, then try to figure out how it can happen in your environment, and then to prioritize detection. So you know, my talk spoke a lot about stuff that wasn't prevent, because the reality is it's very hard to prevent, especially when it comes to third parties. So you do really need to look at detection controls, and that's where those attack paths, you know, you might put it where they're all, you know, there, and that lets you prioritize where to put the controls, rather than trying to fix 20 third parties. Maybe what you can do is, as I say, you find that choke point, you force them and an attacker to go through that choke point, and it gives you a fighting chance in the event of a real incident. I'm not sure if that's a question.
Okay. I think you have, but if Nicole has a follow-up question, I'm sure she will post shortly. In the meantime, we can move on to the next one. Rusa says, you talked about posturing. Can you explain on technologies that you have used and are effective?
So I wouldn't, I wouldn't mention, I wouldn't recommend vendor names, but you know, anybody who has a reputable network stack, you probably already have some of this capability there. So those Mac solutions, they generally have the ability to you know, to put some criteria in place. So, you know, the machine, you know, if it's a Windows machine, it must be fully patched. It must have antivirus that's known and updated. It, you know, maybe it needs to have EDR, you know, whatever your baseline is, you know, that's what you want your tool to be able to do, is to just make sure that that's in place. You know, we're there, you know, I think something like Microsoft uses Intune, if I had to say, give a name off the top of my head, it lets you do some of that management at that level. But I mean, I'd be happy to look into it a bit more and get you a more precise answer if you'd like.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to read a number of questions, then we can see if we can combine some of them or in which order we can address them. So this one is from Michelle. She says, what alternatives do you suggest a security questionnaire for vendor assessments? And Jimmy Zani says, my experience with vendors completing those assessments has been they often rate themselves by evidence or certificates, etc. Then, okay. Dudes, I think, says, are there any merits to audit trailing vendor activity in a log file, which can be useful to providing evidence of mismanagement and company data? I think let's stop there for now before they become too many.
So I'm just going to start with the middle one. So yes, this is the challenge. Anything that's self-reported is you don't know if the person's being very generous with themselves or if they're being overly critical, you know, which is again why I really suggest the dialogue. You know, it and I understand that this isn't practical to do with, you know, if you've got 1,000 vendors, this is not really practical to take this time. But again, by prioritizing those ones, if they are on a critical environment, it's you're better off getting a really good answer and understand than getting a lot of them and the information is inaccurate. Sorry. So what was the first question again? I kind of missed that one.
The first one said...
I suppose I could look in the chat.
I'll read it for you now.
Ah, here we go. Alternative to suggestion to security questionnaires for vendor assessments. Yeah. So obviously something that's already been done by an independent third party. So if somebody does have ISO, they have been audited by somebody else. You know, my experience and background, I would like some physical technical testing. You know, is this an organization that's doing penetration testing? You know, I think that for me is quite a red flag. Anytime I get into a place where there's an organization and they're, you know, we've built this application that integrates with the banks, and you say, okay, have you done a pen test? And they say, no, we've done some scans. You want a little bit concerned because, you know, unless you've had somebody offensively trained really looking at an environment, you're not really going to be able to tell if it's secure or not. So, yes, you know, on the paper side, make sure that somebody independent has credited them, or make sure that they've got something reputable from somebody doing some technical testing, or preferably a bit of both. think there was a third question. Let's see.
Yes, there is another. It says, if clients have nothing or little in place, would you advise that they start with the threat landscape, their security posture, or should they be more holistic and look at getting ISO 27K certified? What would be the most logical starting point?
Yes, and this is honestly something that comes up quite a lot anytime we have a new client. It's trying to understand what the thing is that makes the most sense. And very often that's a bit of a conversation. So again, looking at, even if it is a short workshop, just to do some high level threat modeling to understand what, you know, what the company does, what their potential threats are. And you know, when we say we don't have anything in place, there's normally something in place. And very often it makes sense to do some, again, some sort of technical testing, you know, even if it's some scans on the perimeter, just to make sure that there's nothing obvious. You know, we always want to focus on stopping bad things as quickly as possible. And something like an ISO journey is typically a long journey. It's at least a year of pretty consistent work. And you know, sometimes getting somebody to come and do a penetration test, whether it's a bit of external, a bit of internal, that will at least give you a view of what your posture looks like. And you know, any reputable company should be able to give you a good idea from that of, you know, what you should be worried about and how bad or how good the state is and you know, should you be panicking. And then, as I said, you want to make that as a road to compliance. So we really want to, you know, we want to get to a point where we have those ISO certs, but you want to make sure that you're getting secure along the way. So we're always looking at those sort of low-hanging fruit. What are the things that you can do to immediately improve your posture, but that are part of a broader roadmap? So I think coming up with a roadmap is your best bet. You know, you want to get, you know, again, you want to cut off those script kiddies. You don't want to get taken up by some sort of automated web robot scanner that's just looking for IPs and looking for vulnerable software. You want to get that stuff cleared out so that you can worry about the higher level stuff. And again, I think the certifications particularly are important when dealing with other parties. And that's often the reason that we do get asked about it is, you know, my client is asking for a SOC report, or my client is asking for ISO. You know, people are looking for some sort of proof. So, you know, again, in a conversational point of view, if you are getting this requirement from a client, ask them why they want it and try to come up with a plan that everybody's happy with.
Okay, thank you so much, Trifon. We have used our time to the full. Thank you so much for today's segment and taking us through some practical steps to help us mitigate risk. At this point, I would like to hand over to the chairperson of our region, Robin Williams. Over to you.
Thank you, Lucy. I hope that you can all hear and see me. And good evening to everyone online. For those that don't know me, my name is Robin Williams, and I'm the regional director responsible for the Cape Committee that looks after the Western Cape, the Eastern Cape, and the Northern Cape regions. So onto our next part of the agenda, we have Charles Fischer from PwC, together with his team that will be sharing their experiences and the insights and POPIA implementations that they've performed at various clients, and also share some insights on what is required and what needs to be completed over the next 2 months from a POPIA perspective. So Charles is an associate director at PricewaterhouseCoopers, and he's got over 25 years experience in IT consulting and performing various assurance reviews. He has been providing privacy services for the past 7 years, and his privacy experience includes performing privacy gap assessments and readiness reviews, performing multidisciplinary privacy implementation programs, and then performing privacy internal audit reviews. Charles is a chartered accountant, and he's also a certified information systems auditor, a certified data privacy security engineer, and both his certifications was obtained from ISACA. And then Charles also holds a master's degree in computer auditing. Charles will be joined by his multi-skilled and multidisciplinary privacy team, which consists of Aneesa, Tammy Bortz, and Muneer Ebrahim, and they'll be sharing their insights and experiences on the practical implementation of POPIA from a governance, legal, IT, and security perspective. And then they'll share some what organizations should do and focus on in the next coming 2 months. And then looking beyond that, what should organizations focus on post-June 2021? If you have any questions that you'd like to be answered during the webinar, please post your questions in the Zoom chat facility, and we'll make sure that we answer your questions during the dedicated question and answer slot at the end of the presentation. So Charles, over to you and your team. Thank you.
Thank you for that introduction, Robin. And good evening, fellow members and guests joining us tonight. Give me the opportunity to introduce the extended team that Robin has just referred to in his introduction. So Aneesa is a senior manager in our practice. He's also a CA and CISA, and has also recently been certified as a certified data protection solution engineer. She assists me in running our privacy practice here in the Western Cape. Then we've got Muneer, who's a manager. He's also a CA in CISA, and he's done certifications in privacy enhancing and enterprise tools such as OneTrust. He's our SME in respect of privacy technology enablement and data mapping. And then last but not least, Tammy Bortz. She's a lawyer at Tammy Bortz and Associates, and she works closely with PwC through a joint business relationship that we've got. She has an LLB degree and is a certified international privacy professional with the International Association for Privacy Professionals, the AIPP. She's an SME on many of our local and international projects. Aneesa, over to the next slide for us. Yeah, so Robin has mentioned that we'll be covering these topics today, so I'm not going to repeat this. I just want to just say that yeah, these are some insights that we've learned, some of them the hard way on implementation projects and assurance reviews over the last couple of years, that we will cover under point A, and then we'll talk about what to focus on in the last 2 months before the effective date of 30 June, and then also beyond, and then leave some time for questions. Okay, so before we share these insights, I just wanted to provide some context to the discussion, and on the page you can see the typical phases of a privacy compliance project, as we would normally define them. You would start off typically by trying to understand the applicability of POPIA to your organization by doing a risk analysis or data discovery. Then after that, you will do a gap assessment of your current privacy controls and come up with a roadmap or a project plan in terms of what needs to be planned and implemented as part of your implementation project. And then towards the end, post-June, there will also be a support phase where you will support the business in making sure that you embed privacy properly into the organization. So if what we've seen at our clients and also businesses that we engage with, since the announcement of the effective date in June last year, a lot of organizations have spent quarter three of last year and to extent also quarter four on performing these privacy applicability assessments and gap assessments. And the result of that was that the implementation teams are now under a lot of pressure to make sure that organizations comply by the end of June this year. We've also seen that some organizations that have started quite early back in 2014-15 with their programs, a lot of them had to redo certain of the applicability and gap assessment work, because so much time has passed that the information that they use at that stage has become outdated. Aneesa, the next slide, please. So I'm not going to go through this slide in detail, but it's just an illustration of the typical work streams that you will find as part of the implementation phase of a project. And what I've done here was to map next to each of these work streams the typical part of the functions within the business that will be involved in these work streams. And also the skills that is required. And the point I'm trying to illustrate here is that POPIA is not a legal project or an IT project, but it's actually an enterprise project. And the common theme that we've seen coming through is that the most successful projects are those ones where the business are able to effectively integrate these privacy, governance, legal, IT, infosec, data, and business skills, you know, as part of the program. I'm going to hand over now to the rest of my team, who is going to share with you their insight through different lenses in terms of the respective areas of their expertise. So first, Aneesa will be focusing on governance and compliance insights, then followed by Muneer, who will share technology and data insights, and then lastly, Tammy will share legal insights for us. So over to you, Aneesa.
Thank you, Charles. Let's jump right into it. So governance and accountability. Accountability being one of the key conditions of POPIA, one of the 8 conditions, which makes you responsible for complying with the legislation, and most importantly, being able to demonstrate compliance. So the hottest topic in this area to date has been that of the role of the information officer. There's been so much focus on who this individual should be. And this makes sense, as the fundamental building blocks of accountability is strong leadership and oversight. But fulfilling the role of the information officer is only a small aspect of demonstrating compliance. The key learning, having worked with many organizations creating and implementing the privacy operating models, has been that privacy management is not a task solely for one individual to manage. It is rather a team effort. Organizations need to ensure that the protection of personal information is a shared responsibility, that reporting lines are clear, information flows are effective, and this could mean simply ensuring that throughout the business, there are clear management roles and responsibilities for staff who actually manage privacy in their day-to-day activities. Employees of an organization should be clear and understand what personal information-related activities they are dealing with on a day-to-day, both at a strategic level as well as at operational level. Let's look at some key examples of how compliance can be demonstrated in an organization. Regulation 41A of the regulations issued in terms of POPIA states that an information officer must ensure that a compliance framework is developed, implemented, monitored, and maintained. As mentioned in the previous slide, the POPIA condition accountability requires that responsible parties are able to demonstrate compliance with POPIA, and a privacy compliance framework is one of the main tools that can assist organizations to demonstrate this compliance. Creating and embedding a privacy compliance framework in your organization will show that you set high standards for privacy and lead by example and promote a positive culture and approach to protection of personal information throughout your organization. This is more often demonstrated by organizations through documentation. However, what you actually do in practice, the measures that you put in place, is how you truly demonstrate your compliance with POPIA. Developing a privacy compliance framework is basically taking the 8 conditions of POPIA and ensuring that there are effective controls in place to achieve these conditions. You can think of a framework as a risk and control matrix. Essentially, that includes various categories, for example, accountability, training and awareness, policies and procedures, data subject rights, and breach response management, to name a few. Under each category, you will include relevant controls that you'll perform on an ongoing basis to ensure compliance with POPIA in your organization. So what are we seeing in organizations? What we're seeing, most importantly, is that there is no one-size-fits-all approach. The privacy compliance frameworks we are seeing in practice are used in so many different ways. Some organizations use it to create a comprehensive privacy management program. And there's definitely value in having your compliance framework defined upfront before you embark on your implementation program. The framework serves as a starting point to implementing privacy in your organization, but it also serves as an ongoing monitoring tool for compliance to record, track, and report the privacy measures in place. Another key lesson learned in practice is how important it is to integrate your privacy compliance framework into your existing enterprise compliance framework model. This is to ensure that reporting is aligned and follows the usual process, as opposed to a separate silo and possibly duplicate process. Let's look at another example of demonstrating compliance in terms of POPIA. So another tool to demonstrate compliance is a personal information impact assessment, also known as a PIIA or PIA. Regulation 41B of POPIA introduces a concept of a personal information impact assessment as part of the responsible parties' obligations under POPIA. It states, a personal information impact assessment must be done to ensure that adequate measures and standards exist in order to comply with conditions for lawful processing of personal information. I've tried to highlight on this slide the most common questions we get asked about PIIAs, and I will answer these in light of our current understanding and interpretation, as well as what we understand from other privacy legislation where this requirement also exists. So what is a PIIA? Well, a PIIA is a process designed to help an organization to identify, analyze, and record, and potentially minimize privacy risks, which may result from processing of personal information. It is important because managing privacy risks is a key element of accountability. So when should you actually do it? Well, a PIIA needs to be completed when there's a change in business process or system, ideally as part of a change project, to assess the impact that the changes will have on the privacy risk and ultimately the data subject. Performing a PIIA will help determine whether existing controls will address these risks or whether new controls need to be implemented. So who should actually do a PIIA? A PIIA should be completed by business. The privacy champions or privacy leads, whichever term you prefer to use in your organization, related to these specific business areas which are impacted by the change of the process or the system. So what does it actually look like? We're mentioning PIIA quite often now, but what does it actually look like? It's effectively a questionnaire that you would complete to determine if the change or process of the system impacts the rights of the data subject in any way. It can be a manual document or it can be done in a tool. We have seen some tools at our clients which have questionnaires built into it that can be adapted to meet requirements of the organization. While there is minimal guidance at the moment, our interpretation of the regulations is that it suggests that there is no option to use the risk-based approach, which is the case in other privacy legislations. For example, GDPR, which requires you to do a privacy impact assessment for processing that is likely to result in high risk to individuals. In comparison, our interpretation of POPIA regulation does not limit the carrying out of PIIA only to processing that is likely to result in high risk to rights of data subjects, but requires that PIIAs must be carried out for all processing activities. All privacy risks which could impact data subject rights to privacy should be assessed. So while we patiently wait for more guidance, what can your organization do in the meantime? You could provide training to your employees to understand the need to consider PIIA at early stages of any process or project that they might be involved in, which involves personal information. It is important to empower employees to initiate PIIAs. It would be impossible for the privacy office or the information officer to know everything that is happening in an organization. If all business functions had to first go to the privacy office or the information officer to initiate PIIAs or to complete it, there would be inefficiencies and delays holding up business to complete these, as there would be a bottleneck. The business functions need to understand what those triggers are and that these built-in triggers should act as gates before proceeding into any change in the organization. For example, implementing a new system. No new system can be implemented or should be implemented without completing a PIA. And finally, the insight on what your organization can work on in the meantime is to identify the business functions who deal the most with PI, as these are the functions who are most likely going to perform PIAs more often. And it's therefore important that they understand and feel knowledgeable and equipped to perform these assessments. And I'll hand you over to Muneer, who will share some technology and data insights with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Aneesa. As Charles mentioned in the introduction, you know, I've been involved with some of our clients in taking them on a journey to reach compliance, and I've predominantly been focused on their technology journey. So today I thought I'd speak about some of the key challenges they've been facing, and I'll focus on two today. The first one is around the data inventory, and then I'll be talking about data subject rights and embedding a process to support that mechanism. I've got a few minutes. I'm just going to focus on some of the key aspects, and I've got some reference items on the sheet that you can reflect on afterwards. So the first thing I want to do is talk about the data inventory, what it is, why you do it, and how you go about doing a data inventory. And the first thing to mention is that, you know, a data inventory is not something that's promulgated by the Act. It's not forced on you, but it is fundamental to achieving some of the other compliance objectives that is a compliance requirement. And so a data inventory is really a repository of how your personal information moves across the various phases of its life cycle. And so you can think of it as a record or a table, a database. It can take many forms, but the ultimate objective is to support some of your other compliance projects and initiatives that you have underway. And so what I've got on the left is a reflection of those various phases that you potentially want to have captured on your data inventory. And in the middle block, I've talked about some of the key whys that you might be wanting to do a data inventory for. The key one I want to touch on is the data subject request process. And if you think about data subject rights, you know, a data subject is able to come to a client and ask them about, you know, what data they hold on them. Can ask to correct, amend, delete the data. And in order to do or fulfill a request of that nature, you know, an organization needs to have a clear view on where personal information resides and the type of data that they hold on the data subject. And so that's sort of a clear-cut rationale for a data inventory. And in terms of the approach you take, the how, there's various different ways, but I think I'll just leave you with one thought, in that we typically find organizations either following top-down, bottoms-up, or hybrid approach. And essentially what that is alluding to is with a top-down approach, you're really utilizing understanding of the processes, using workshops and questionnaires to develop an understanding of where personal information resides. And a bottoms-up approach is really about leveraging tools to do data discovery and using the data to inform some of the decision-making around the inventory. So I'll leave you with that on the slide. And maybe Aneesa, if you can move on to the next one. What I wanna do on the next slide is really just talk about some of the key lessons learned that we've sometimes understood the long way or the hard way. And we've helped clients use technology to do a data inventory. We've also followed a very manual-based approach for data inventory. One approach is not appropriate for all clients. So it's really about what you intend on using the data inventory for, whether you have technology to support or are willing to invest in technology to support the data inventory. But I think there's some clear cut considerations that you need to make. And so the first one I want to talk about is making sure that you follow or do appropriate scoping. And typically when we do a data inventory, some of the key things you need to consider is making sure that you cover all the processes that deal with personal information. And we typically call those your processing activities. And the other thing you wanna make sure of is that you've scoped in all the assets that hold personal information. And that can be logical assets. It can also be physical assets that reside personal information. The other point I want to make mention of, the second one, is around embedding your data inventory into your existing data governance practices. And so if you've already got quite good and a mature data governance practice, you want to make sure that the data inventory is not sitting in silo and it touches on your existing data classification models, your existing retention mechanisms, et cetera, so that it can support and even enhance your existing data governance. The third thing, which is quite a topical point of discussion with our clients when developing a data inventory, is to decide on the primary key that they use. And what I mean by this is that your record that you use that's hosted in your data inventory can have a reference to the processing activity, or it can be very specific to the asset. And that's a decision you need to make. There's a lot of other considerations, but I think I will leave that that consideration for now. And if you have any further questions, we can definitely pick that up in the questions. There's a few points I want to group together because they talk hand in hand. And I think the ones I want to loop together is point 5 and 6, which is about making sure you have the right people involved in your process and making sure that the questionnaires respondents that are involved in answering some of the data inventory questions you have are the right individuals. And what I mean by that is that at the end of the day, your data inventory needs to talk about privacy across the business. And so the first point is that you need to make sure that the people that's involved in your data inventory exercise are representative of your business, but that secondly, they understand the various use cases of personal information and they understand what the end objective is of the data inventory exercise. The other point I want to make mention of is that you shouldn't underestimate the effort or overestimate the quality that you'll get out of the first round of a data inventory. And we've seen clients that are able to do a data inventory within a month, but then end up spending 2 to 3 to even 5 months with improving the quality because one, the respondents weren't clear on what the objective was, or two, they underscoped the exercise and then forgot about certain business functions at the end of the day. The other thing I want to make mention of is that you want to make sure you cover the life cycle of personal information. And it talks hand in hand with the next point, which is about making sure that the right third parties or third parties are reflected in your data inventory. And a lot of the times you'll have third party dependencies within a process. And it's important that your data inventory supports that understanding as well, because fundamentally, if a data subject comes to you with a data subject rights request again, you know, you might need to action on any third party data that resides outside of your own infrastructure. I think the last point I just want to make mention of on the slide is really just to say that, you know, once you've done with the nitty-gritties of, you know, sending out questionnaires, developing a data inventory, what's quite important is that you just take a step back and have a look holistically at what the messages are that are coming out of your data inventory. Because, you know, you want to make sure that transfers between processes are adequately captured, and you want to make sure that the core messages and the core assets that you use within your organization are covered as part of the data inventory so that it works hand in hand with some of your other privacy initiatives. Aneesa, if you wouldn't mind just moving on to the next slide. What I want to talk about now is data subject rights, and we've alluded to it earlier. I want to talk about some of the key components to a DSR program. But, you know, this is a compliance requirement. This is subject to Section 23, 24, and 25 of POPIA. And essentially, the Act asks that we create mechanisms for our data subjects to, you know, either confirm the PI held, request deletion where there's no longer lawful basis to hold it. They could also request the correction or deletion or access to PI. So those are some of the data subject rights requests that you need to manage. And in very simplistic terms, there's two core components to this. The one is that you have adequate entry points to facilitate these requests. So in other words, making sure you capture all the requests as it comes through. And you want to make sure you have sufficient entry points in line with how you typically engage with your data subjects. And that could be through your website, it could be through email portals, it could be through an intranet, etc. And you want to make sure that you have those adequate mechanisms available to solicit and manage these requests. The other core component to a DSR program is really to make sure you have adequate workflows in the background and workflows so that you are able to standardize how you respond to these requests and respond in the most appropriate way, you know. some of these requests might challenge your existing data. And so you might have a need for mechanisms to either update data. You might need mechanisms to basically delete data. And with that comes also the necessary approvals that you need to put in place. And the way I typically like to explain this to clients is to say that you need to almost triage the requests that come through and have separate workflows depending on the nature of the request and depending on the assets that are impacted by the request. So for example, you might need to ensure that legal gets involved. If there's a very subjective request that comes through, it might be around deletion. And you, of course, you might need your data owners involved to make sure that they are approving the request and also updating the assets if there's any amendments needed. Some of the other aspects I want to touch on here is really just to say that, you know, in fulfilling those requests, you need to make sure, firstly, that you authenticate the data subject because it can quickly turn into a data breach if you're not sure of the validity of the requester. So these are some of the considerations. I think I've covered some of the key ones. And if there's any questions, please feel free to ask. I think the key message here is that you need to have a process in place that's auditable, standardized, and allows you to make sure you're meeting SLAs that you put in place for yourself. And with that being said, I'm going to hand over to my colleague, Tammy, who's going to be touching on some of the key legal lessons learned today. So over to you, Tammy. Thanks.
Okay, thanks, Muneer. Thank you for that. Okay, so I think just as a starting point, one of the key lessons that I've learned working on the various POPIA projects is that POPIA projects are not just legal. Underlying all of the legal requirements is a lot of other groundwork and frameworks that need to be put in place to ensure there can be compliance with the letter of the law, as they say. So what I'm going to touch on now is just some of the, what they refer to as the document shield or some of the documentation that is a requirement of POPIA that has to be put in place and ready by the 1st of July. So just underlying what everyone refers to as your privacy notice, which I'll come to, is this whole concept of lawful grounds of processing. And what that essentially means, as you may well know, is that one of the main requirements of POPIA is that you can't just use someone's personal information for any reason. There needs to be justifications or lawful grounds for processing of this personal information. And five grounds are given in POPIA. And what's become more and more evident is that consent is not the best ground to rely on, or it's not the only ground that you can rely on to process personal information. In fact, consent should be your last resort as a ground for processing because consent can be withdrawn. So if your data subject comes along and says, well, you know, I originally consented to use, but now I don't want you to use my personal information anymore, you have to stop using it. And that could impact on the business in terms of possibly contracts that may have been entered into, etc. So the better approach, and this is where you would rely on things like your data mapping, is to look at the other grounds, lawful grounds. A very important one is the conclusion of performance of a contract. And most businesses collect information as part of the contracting process. So for example, internally, your employment contract. So whereas, other than things like special personal information, you would need to collect a substantial amount of employee information to firstly decide if you want to employ an employee, and so that's your pre-employment information, and then to onboard or conclude a contract. So there you don't need consent, you need the information to conclude the employment contract. And the same applies, for example, with a customer agreement. you don't need consent from a customer to use personal information that is necessary to conclude the contract. And then also there's where the law requires you to collect personal information, such as, for example, the Employment Equity Act, where you have to collect things like race information or the Basic Conditions of Employment Act. The law says you have to collect the following information. In those circumstances, again, you don't need to get consent to collect the information. So, and then the other ground which is used, which is, I'm not going to go into how it can be determined what is a legitimate interest, but that is very important to consider that where none of the other grounds can be used. And that is where you need to consider if the processing is necessary for a business purpose or a legitimate reason that is in favor of either the company or the data subject. So for example, if you need to collect data for fraud prevention, for example, or to assess whether you should grant credit, for example, those may be circumstances where it's in the best interest of the company to collect the data and you may not need consent. And I just want to qualify that by saying you would need to consider whether legitimate interest does apply in certain circumstances, because the one important consideration is that the collection and use or the means of collection and use mustn't override the privacy rights of the data subject. And if they do override those rights to privacy, the business must be able to justify that and explain why they can override those privacy rights. So as I say, it's important that a company understands why they process personal information and what the processing purposes are, that they can actually consider and make sure that one of these grounds is present so that they are lawfully processing this personal information. Aneesa, next slide. So the next area that I'm going to touch on is this concept of privacy notices. And what this really is that, again, POPIA has a requirement that says when you are collecting personal information from a data subject, you need to take reasonably practical steps to bring certain information to the attention of the data subject. And this goes to this issue of transparency, so that the data subject can understand why you're collecting the information, what you're collecting, what are you going to be using it for, who else may it be given to, and if it's going to be transferred offshore, et cetera. So I'm not going to go through every line item of the section. You can go and look at section 18 on your own, but just some of the important aspects that you would need to have in the notice, for example, is, as I mentioned, on what grounds or how does the organization justify that they allowed to process or collect that information? And that's what we've just touched on in the previous slide. You need to tell the data subject in your privacy notice why you are using their personal information and to say to them, we are using it lawfully because either we have to be using it to comply with a contract or to conclude a contract, or we are using it because the law says we have to use it or collect it. So that also goes to your privacy notice. For example, the other thing is that you need to let the data subject know if you're going to transfer the information offshore, that goes to your cross-border data transfer. And if you are, where to, and will it be sufficiently protected in that other jurisdiction? So this is the list of what you need to set out. As Muneer touched on, your data subject rights, that also needs the process or the rights of the data subject to request access or deletion correction must also be in your notice. And just more importantly, the question is, how must this notice be presented? Now, what's important to note is that this privacy notice doesn't have to be accepted in writing or signed by the data subject. It talks about it must be brought to the attention of the data subject. And so deciding how you are going to do that will depend on the access points or the entry points of that data. So for example, if you have an e-commerce site and a user has to go online and register, and at the point of registration, they need to enter certain information. What you'll often see is that there's a place to tick to say, I accept the terms and conditions and the privacy terms. By ticking that box and next to that box referring to the privacy policy or the privacy terms, that's drawing the user's attention to the privacy notice. Another example, an entry point could be a call center. And your, the call center recorded message or the call center operator must orally draw the terms to the attention of the caller. So again, you'd need to go through an assessment. It may just be signing a filling in a physical form, and there you could just refer to your privacy policy at the bottom of your form. So you need to look at your access point and decide which is the best way to reasonably bring the notice to the attention of the data subject. Okay, next slide. Okay, the last paper or document that I'm going to touch on here that is also an absolute requirement of POPI is what is referred to as your operator agreement or your third party service provider agreement. It's given various names. But the substance of it is that where an organization uses a third party service provider to perform any processing of personal information on its behalf, and that third party is not able to manipulate the information or make decisions as to how that information is used, but they merely are processing it or using it to render a certain service, that party or third party is referred to as an operator under POPI. And under GDPR, you'll hear the word data processor. And what POPI requires is that the agreement between an organization and this operator must be in writing, and there is certain information or certain things that must be set out in that contract. The first one, importantly, is that the operator can only use the information based on the authorization or the instructions of the responsible party. And that you will put a statement of that nature in the agreement. You can also say, for example, that it will only be used to render the services. The services would then need to be clearly set out in the contract. But what must be very clear is that the operator cannot use the information for any other purpose. It must be the use must be very clearly limited to what the operator has been appointed to do on behalf of the responsible party. And a good example is always given is, for example, a payroll provider. So you're using a third party to process your payroll. They receive employee information purely to prepare payment slips, to prepare documentation for SARS and for UIF and for other regulatory bodies. They then submit the pay slip. They cannot then go and use that information, for example, to contact the employee or to market to the employee or anything else. It's very limited. Then you also get things like a disaster recovery provider, where literally they are only entitled to process the information to ensure disaster recovery and availability in the event of a disaster, etc. Then secondly, the operator must only must treat the information as confidential information, so you would need a confidentiality clause. Importantly, the operator must take the access, appropriate, reasonable, and technical measures to prevent loss of or unauthorized access or destruction of the personal information. And there, the Act doesn't prescribe what that would be, okay? It leaves it quite wide, but what organizations are doing here is that they are saying, based on a risk assessment of the provider, we will say what technical measures need to be put in place, and those will be attached as a schedule to the agreement. So again, important document to have in place. It is a requirement of POPIA to have that in place, and these need to be in place by the 1st of July. So that comes to the end of my presentation. If there are any questions, please put them in the chat, and we will try and get to them, as many of the questions as possible. Thank you, and I'm now handing back to Charles.
Thank you, Tammy. So I'm just the last section of our presentation before we do the questions. I just wanted to finish off on a bit of a positive note. So if you're feeling under pressure at the moment, I think just it's important to note that there's various references in the Act to that provide project teams with discretion with the implementation of privacy measures. You see various references that's made to reasonable and practical measures. So my reading of that is that privacy, like any other management process, will mature over time. And provided that you've got the right operating model and compliance structures in place, I think the idea would not be to be 100% compliant or have everything perfect by the end of June, but to leave yourself some room for improvement over the coming years. So in terms of the big question, so what should organizations focus on over the next 2 months? My suggestion here would be that before you get to the end of this month is to do a review of your implementation plan and to check whether it is realistic, you know. And then to identify, are there any areas on the plan, especially if your project is under pressure, that you could potentially push out to post June, and ways that you can go about to determine whether that will still make you materially compliant would be to first focus on aspects that is very specifically mentioned in the Act. You know, if I can take an example here, Muneer mentioned earlier that the data inventory and data mapping is not specified, but there's a very good business reason for that. Another example would be, you know, data classification. That is also always something that we struggle to do. There's no requirement in the Act to do it. So that could be something, although it's a very good practice, that you can do post-June. Aneesa mentioned the privacy impact assessments and the compliance framework. Those things are very specifically defined in the Act, so you won't be able to push that out. You need to put that in place. Another thing that organizations do is to take an outside-in view of the organization and to focus on external-facing policies, forms, notices, and make sure that these are all compliant with POPIA. Just a word of caution here, one must be careful yet of doing window dressing, because that might also catch you up over the longer term. Another key point to consider is to review your network security and data loss prevention measures, because the last thing that you want is to have a data breach, because that definitely will have serious repercussions for your organization. And then the quick win would be to register your information officer. And as Tammy mentioned earlier, you know, to transfer the liability by putting in place these third-party operator agreements that at least if something goes wrong, that you could that you can manage the liability that you as an organization will face. If we look into the longer term beyond the end of June, I think the focus should really then be on introducing efficiencies through a continuous improvement process within your privacy program. Examples of this would be to further embed the policies and SOPs in your organization. Some mechanisms that organizations do is to have to present advanced training on these areas, and also to create what we refer to as communities of practice, where your business users that deals with privacy on a day-to-day basis can get together and share good practices and discuss the challenges that they have. In terms of the data quality and the data inventories, you know, I'll be very surprised if anybody's data inventories at this stage is better than the 70% in terms of accuracy. So that will leave plenty of room over the coming years for continuous improvement to improve the quality and the accuracy of your data inventories. You might also find that there's a number of security safeguard and data destruction technical challenges that you're facing. Instead of rushing these things, take a longer term view, focus on the key risk areas for now, and then give yourself some more time to work on that over the coming months. And then I think that the last one I just wanted to highlight here is tools. You know, we often think that tools will solve all our problems. In fact, we found on other international projects, you know, that it actually takes up to 2 years to fully embed these privacy enhancement and enterprise tools, you know. So we advise our clients not to put tools on the critical path necessary unless you started with the implementation of that way back, you know, rather than run that in parallel with putting maybe some hybrid or manual processes in place for now, and then you can always embed your tools post June. So those are just a couple of thoughts that I wanted to leave you with at the end of the session. So we're going to now go over to the questions. I don't think we've got a lot of time. Maybe Robin, can we get 5 minutes, or how much time do we have for the questions?
Yeah, I think we can go till 6 o'clock, and then we'll start wrapping up the event. So I see quite a number of questions coming through. We can definitely tackle them.
Yes, thanks, Robin. So yeah, I know I've saw some of these questions in. I'm just going to maybe deal with the first one that I saw earlier on. There was a question. So what should organizations do if they haven't yet commenced with their privacy program, given that we've got 2 months left, you know? I think I get this question quite a lot. So I think what is important here is that the organization must make peace with it that they will not likely be compliant by the end of June. But then please don't sit and do nothing. There is definitely a motivation for you to kick off your program as soon as possible, because the expectation would be that the regulator would look at it favorably if you at least have done some work up to June if there's a breach and you get investigated. So I would suggest that you then start off with your key information assets. Maybe it's your consumer data. Make sure that your breach, your data loss prevention and network security controls are appropriate to prevent the data breach. Focus on the external facing policies and notices. And you'll see there's a lot that you can actually do in the following 2 months to get a head start, you know, and these points that we discussed earlier in terms of other points that you could also consider in the next 2 months, you know, like the things specifically mentioned in the Acts in terms of putting that paper shield in place, your policy and your governance framework, etc. Those things you can work on already in the next 2 months, and those are some quick wins that you can achieve if you start immediately. I saw there was also a question that I'm going to ask Aneesa to answer. There's a lot of confusion around this registration of the information officer and the portal that is opening on the 1st of May. So maybe Aneesa, there was a question about that. Do we have any further clarity in terms of whether that is a deadline or whether that is the starting date for when organizations can start registering their information officers and deputies?
Thanks, Charles. So there's definitely two views on this. Some people are thinking that it's the only day and everyone's stressing and planning their weekend around registering on the 1st of May, being Saturday. Then there are others that are saying that it's impossible, that it can only be one day. So, you know, there hasn't really been a statement from the information regulator stating that it is only that day. However, looking into this, I think there was an alert in March, sometime mid-March, by the information regulator on one of their social media pages that suggested that, you know, the registering of the information officer will be an ongoing process, and it will open on the 1st of May, which, you know, if we read between the lines, it does suggest that it's something that will be ongoing and sort of that will be the first day. And then there was also a statement on the 1st of April that was released by the information regulator's office that said that, I think they used the word commence. So on the 1st of May, the commencement of the information officer registration will happen. So I think looking at that, it does suggest that it will be an ongoing and then it's not the deadline day. But yeah, without that, you know, definitive sentence coming out or alert by the information regulator, I would suggest that, if you can register on the 1st of May, please go ahead and do that. And then hopefully there will be some clarity in this week still, since it's happening on Saturday.
Yeah, I think I guess the prudent thing to do here is to follow the manual process. If you're really concerned about being non-compliant and register through the manual process that is already available, we know that it is a deadline. But then I agree there's a lot of confusion here in terms of this portal and the practicality of registering on Workers' Day on the 1st of May just doesn't make a lot of sense. So hopefully we will get some clarity during the next couple of days and about that. Then there was a question, and I think this one is for you, Muneer, in terms of data cataloging. What type of tools did you use to do the data cataloging? And then also at what level in the business did you do this? Can you maybe share some insights with our audience?
Sure, thanks for that. So look, we've helped clients that followed a technology-based approach and we've helped ones that are more manual intensive. And I suppose there's no right or wrong answer, but when it came to the automation side of things, you know, I've helped with clients implement OneTrust as a tool, and that has its own native technology in there for you to actually send out questionnaires, develop the inventory, even do a visual representation of that lineage between assets and processes. But at a very simplistic level, I've also helped clients do it using Excel, using VBA script to develop a questionnaire and then scripting to actually consolidate the data. But that is not needed. You know, you can scale that down and actually just use Excel as your database table. And in terms of the level of detail we would go down, so it's very much at the discretion of the client, depending on what type of insights they want to derive out of that data inventory. But to answer your question, a lot of clients have opted to firstly understand their functions and then group their functions into, let's say, the top five processes within those functions, and then use those processes as the level of detail that they want to zoom in when they capture the responses to the data inventory. And conversely, some clients have opted to go the asset-centric approach, in which case they've identified all the assets in the business that are essentially holding personal information. So there's no right or wrong answer, but the ultimate decision-making factor is really about what type of insight do you want to derive out of your inventory and what are you going to be using it for? And I think that will inform the level of detail that you want to go into when developing your data inventory. Hopefully that answered the question.
Thanks, Muneer. And then I see there's a whole bunch of questions with a legal angle to it. So Tammy, as I promised you before the session, that I'm going to give you all the difficult ones. So there's a question here in terms of data leakage, you know, and if there are any thresholds, or does it imply if one record has been leaked that you will have to to follow the data breach procedures, or is there a threshold that you can set and say if it's above 100 or 50, we will?
Yeah, so I can. There's no threshold. Like the GDPR, there's no threshold. Any breach, any unlawful access of personal information needs to be reported to the regulator and to the data subject, if reasonably possible.
Okay.
Simple then, answer.
Yeah, so then I don't know. So there's the next one here, Tammy. Then, so how do your clients manage the information of their existing data subjects that do not consent to the collection, processing, and storage of their personal information?
Okay, so that's quite a long answer. So basically, what you would need to do from day the 1st of July is you would need a process in place to send the privacy notice to all your existing data subjects. And, you know, I know that's not always simple or straightforward, but you'd have to establish a way to do it based on your entry points, based on the type of data subjects, etc. And in the notice, you would need to set out what you're using the data, what's in the notice, and then give the data subject the opportunity at that point to come back and say, well, I don't want you to process my personal data anymore. And you would have to decide at that point, was the usage based on consent in the first place? Because they can only remove consent if consent was the original basis on which you are using the personal information. So they may say, I no longer consent to using my information. And at that point, you may be able to say, but actually we're not using it based on consent. We're using it based on the fact that we have to collect it in terms of a law or to ensure we can comply with the contract with you. And so you cannot remove consent in those circumstances. So it's not, you know, straightforward, but you'd have to go through that process. If a data subject comes forward and says, well, I'd no longer want you to process my information. Not sure that answer. I can't see the question on the chat.
That's perfect. I'm just going to slip in one last question then. It's around operators also, given that you've covered that topic, Tammy. So in the event that the PI is used by the operator, in this case, outside the scope mandated, who is answerable at the end of the day in terms of POPIA?
So that's a very good question. Firstly, because you have to have a contract in place, it's important that that agreement or that contract sets out the penalties for the operator in the event of a breach of the agreement. So, you know, you would set out there whether there's a damages claim and what that liability would be in the event of a breach. Under POPIA, interestingly enough, very little obligations are imposed on the operator themselves. Most of the penalties and the and that rests on the responsible party. So it would be because of that, it is very important also why you need this contract in place to make sure that you do have some kind of recourse or sanction against the operator for misuse of that information.
Okay, thanks, Damien. I think that then concludes our session. Thank you for allowing us this extra time for the questions. Back to you, Robin.
Thanks, Charles. Just give me a second, so I'm going to share my screen. Okay, just confirm if you can see my screen.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. I see there was quite a bit of questions coming through. Thank you for that. Sorry that we couldn't get through to all the questions, but what we'll try is that we'll see if we can get some of those questions answered offline, but really thank you for that engagement in the chat. And then Charles, to you and your team, thank you so much for those insights. You know, with POPIA coming into effect in the next 2 months, I'm quite sure that our audience has taken some value from this presentation, and I can apply some of these insights that were shared as part of the POPIA journey and the implementations.
Thank you. It's a pleasure, Robin.
And then just a big thank you again to our two speakers for such insightful presentations on your topic around third party risk management and then POPIA implementations. We strive to continue to improve our events and make our webinars topical and relevant, you know, in line with our members' expectations. We have previously sent a link where you can complete evaluation forms to provide us feedback, and we appreciate any feedback that you can give. Like I said, that helps us ensure that we're relevant and we drive the right value to our members. And we will be posting the link again if you missed it in the chat. And then with traditional soccer style, we got competition time again. No, this time we didn't do a riddle or a question, but we did a lucky draw. So I'd like to congratulate our winner for the lucky draw, if I can have a drum roll. So well done to our prize winner, Vincent Basingi. The SARC office will be in contact with you to make sure that you get your prize. And then just some final reminders and important announcements. I know we did go through this at the beginning of it, of the webinar. So regarding the online conference, we are hosting the conference online on the 7th and the 8th of June. We do have quite an exciting lineup of speakers that will present on the topics that's in line with our theme, adapting changing times. We have also some international speakers part of the lineup and exciting entertainment online. So if you haven't registered, the registrations are still open and that can be done on the SARCA website. And then on the sponsorship side, we still have packages available starting from as little as 4,000 Rand. If your company is interested in sponsoring, contact our office for assistance and they can give you a rundown on the benefits that each of these packages offer. And then keeping to our tradition of having a pre and post conference workshop, as a pre-conference event, we have Shane Naidu that will be holding a one-day workshop on auditing RPA technologies. And we have our past chapter president, Tich Zozoro, and they'll be doing a two-day COVID 2019 Foundations post-conference workshop. There are group discounts available and the registrations for these events are open. You can visit our ISAC Engage page to visit or to register for these events, or you can contact our office for any assistance that you require. Also, we are having our AGM that will be taking place on the 19th of May. And this is where our chapter president, Darlene Bormunk, and our treasurer, Francois Leroux, will be giving our members an update on the chapter strategy and the finances. You can also visit the SARCA website if you'd like to attend. And also just to note that this is the last webinar before the conference, and we will miss everyone until we return on the 23rd of June, where we have a professional forum that will be hosted by the Johannesburg region. And this brings us to a close to our event. So thank you again to our speakers, Trifon from IfSecure, and then Charles, Aneesa, Tammy and Muneer from PwC for sharing the expertise and the insight and taking the time to speak at our event. Your presentations were quite insightful and very relevant, as these are quite topical issues at the moment. I'd like to also thank the Cape Regional Committee, including a very special thank you to our new department for putting this event together. A lot of time and effort goes into putting something like this together, and teamwork really goes a long way. And then to our audience, I'd like to thank you for your attention and your participation during the event. And then lastly, in the spirit of Freedom Day, I want to leave you with a saying from one of our most inspirational leaders of our time, Nelson Mandela. So for to be free is not merely to cast off one's chains, but to live in a way that respects and enhances the freedom of others. And on that note, we'll be playing out a song about freedom, hope, and I hope that you enjoy it. So from my side, goodbye, God bless, and stay safe.
Hold on to me, don't let me go. Who cares what they see? Who cares what they know? Your first name is free, last name is dumb, but you still believe
we're from. Man's white flower. Your first name is King, last name is Dumb, 'cause you still believe in everyone. The sun. Freedom.